Christ, you guys can be seated. Well, thank you. There's one good morning. I appreciate that. We are so excited that each and every one of you are here today. My name is Kristen Smith, and I'm the Director of Operations here at Grace. If this is your first time worshiping with us, we would love if you would fill out this Connect card that's located inside of your bulletin, tear it off, and bring it to either me or Natalie at the Next Steps or the Welcome Booth. We have a goodie bag for you. We want to make sure that you get it. Just so you know what to expect from the remainder of the service today, we have a couple more songs. We are going to do the Lord's Supper together, and then Pastor Steve is going to finish up his series on resisting God, our study of Jonah. The last thing that I want to let you know about is that we have several ways that you can give here at Grace, but we also want you to know that if you're new here, we want you to sit back and enjoy the presence of God. We have no expectations. This time, I'm going to turn it over to Danielle. She has lots of things to say.
But we're going to start with good morning, Grace. Good morning. There we go. That was so much better. They like me more than you this morning. I'm just kidding. All right, good morning, y'all. So first up, we have midweek studies starting back, and that includes our family night that has our children and our youth. But those activities can't start up without our adult help. So if you are interested in helping and getting involved, you can stop at the Next Steps booth and fill out a form and talk to Kristen or Natalie, and we can get you plugged in so that we can start those weeks back up. The next thing is, this week we have these really cool sermon notes for our kids. And so if you have a child, during our meet and greet time here in just a moment, you can send them out to the foyer to pick one of these up. And so each week these are going to change based on Pastor Steve's notes. Or his sermons, so then that way the kids can follow along and have a fun activity, but also get a little bit out of Steve's sermon as well. So that you can pick those up at the Next Steps booth. Next up, it is time for fantasy football again. Yeah, I hear some of you. All right. So on August the 24th at 7 p.m. in the warehouse, it's going to be draft night. And so I know that the title and belt are up for grabs by Rodney. Is Rodney in here right now? He's not in here. He's our current holder. So somebody's got to come in draft night and beat him this year. Okay? So who's up to the challenge? Not me either. All right. Okay, and last that I have for you today is we have a new life group that's getting ready and to begin, and it's called Ready to Launch. And so today at the 11 o'clock service, they are going to be meeting in the link. And so this is just a life group for married couples whose kids are launching into college, whose kids are launching into adulthood, and who you are now becoming maybe empty nesters, maybe you still have some at home, but you're ready to launch your marriage and your children into a different phase in life. And so if that's you, we would love to have you come to the meet and greet today during the 11 o'clock service so that you can get plugged in as well. There are other things going on, so make sure that you're opening your bulletin and reading them. And then if you will stand and greet one another, we will continue in worship.
Thank you. ways that we know that God is good is because he sent his son to die for us, and what he endured on the cross tells us that Jesus is good, because what he endured on the cross took what we deserved and placed it upon himself. And when somebody takes what you deserve and places it upon themselves, there's no other explanation for that other than they're good. Even if you're not, they're good. And so Lord's Supper is our opportunity to recognize that God is good, that he's been far better to us than we could ever deserve, that what he has done for us is really, in many ways, unthinkable, that he would take our sin to the point of death and punishment, that he would take that upon himself. So that's what we remember today. And you should have these elements. If you would, take out the bread. If you don't have these elements, raise your hand. We'll get them to you. Take out the bread. The bread represents the body of Christ that was broken for us. Now Jesus endured such torment and pain on our behalf. When Jesus met with his disciples, he said the bread represents his body, which was broken for us, and that we're to take and eat. And the juice represents the blood of Christ that was poured out so that we could have forgiveness. And so Jesus met with his disciples and said, "Take and drink." Father, we're thankful for your son, Jesus. We're thankful for what he did for us. We're thankful for the fact that he took what we deserved upon himself, and that he was broken for us, crushed for us, blood poured out for us, so that we could even be here today. And it's astounding what Jesus went through so that we could worship him. It's astounding what he went through so that we could live and escape eternal torment. And so we are thankful beyond words today, Lord, Jesus, and we remember him this morning, and we pray in Jesus' name.
We repent. church who bear your light, lamp of flame, city bright, King and kingdom come is what we pray. We need a fresh wind, the fragrance of
Jesus, that's just our prayer, God, today, that you'll pour your spirit out upon this place, God. Know that we can just worship you, Lord, freely. God, that we can experience you today in a way that we never have. God, I pray that, Lord, you just overwhelm this place, Lord. God, we thank you for all that you do for us. God, we thank you for your son and his sacrifice. Lord, I thank you for this place, the people that are here, Lord. And again, I pray that you open hearts and minds, God, for what you have today. We love you so much. In your name, amen.
Amen, amen. Great to see y'all today. I want to let you know something right as we start off. We have a really unique situation here where we have partnerships with three schools within Corsicana Independent School District. We partner with Navarro Elementary and Carroll Elementary and Corsicana High School. And the district has been generous enough to open their doors to us and to allow us to come in there and do all kinds of things that that you just don't hear about within, like, between churches and schools. And so we're very thankful for that partnership. And I had the chance to pray for CISD's convocation this week and was able to get some video from some of the leaders in Corsicana School District to just share with you what that partnership means to them. So if y'all would, go ahead and play that video and y'all watch along. All right, y'all, I'm here with Kamar Chambers. Kamar is one of our, member of our school board.
Yes, sir.
And a good friend. And we're thankful for him and all he does. Thankful for the barbecue he makes and everything he does in our community. Kamar, as a school board member, you know, we have three partnerships as a church with three different campuses in CISD. As a school board member, do you think that's helpful for the schools, and what do you think it does for the morale of the schools just to have that support?
Man, the biggest thing that I like about that is that when I first became a school board member, I said one of my biggest things was to try to bridge the gap between community and district. And so to see that, to see the church, first and foremost, that's normally obsolete, that's normally not around, it's a huge, a huge thing for us. It helps with the school board, it helps with the district all together, you know what I mean? So we say thank you so much for what you're doing. We appreciate you, Brother Steve, man, and Grace. You guys do an amazing job. So, but yes, it is absolutely phenomenal to see the church coming and getting involved. So it means a lot.
Hey, man, appreciate you,
yes,
everything
sir.
You do. Thanks for being a good friend. Thanks for being a community leader. Just everything you do, man,
yes, sir.
We appreciate you.
Yes, sir, no doubt. Thank you.
All right, bye. Just one.
Okay.
This is Mr. Doring. He's a principal at Corsicana High School. And he's got a hard job. He's got a lot to oversee. Mr. Doring, we have a partnership with your school where we get to provide a few things to hopefully help out around here. Is it helpful? And just give our people a little idea of what it does for y'all.
No, it's 100% helpful. It means so much to us. It means so much to our teachers. And it also impacts our kids, because when our teachers are happy, then it directly is a reflection to our kids. So the partnership means a lot to us. They do so much for us, provide meals for our teachers, and shows so much appreciation to them. We are very appreciative to the church and Pastor Hayes for providing that and doing that for us.
Awesome, man. Well, thank you for being a principal who lets us do this and who gives us this kind of access. We appreciate it so much. It doesn't happen everywhere, and so we don't take it for granted. We appreciate you. Thank you.
Thank y'all. Appreciate
it. All right, y'all. I'm here with Dr. Frost, the superintendent of Corsicana Independent School District. Dr. Frost, tell us real quick. We have a partnership with three of your campuses, and we really enjoy it. Does it make a difference for y'all?
What you do for our campuses is incredible. Not only does it improve morale, but it makes a statement about our community's caring and love for our teachers, our children, and our staff. So every time that you're on campus, if it's a lunch, no matter what you do, we appreciate you. And we know that Corsicana ISD is a better district because of our partnership with Grace Church.
Oh, that's so awesome. Thank you. You
thank
were
you.
Worried about whether you're going to save it. You did great.
Thank you.
And thank you so much for being a superintendent who even allows this. You know, just it's unusual to have this kind of partnership, and we feel the support and the love of that, and we love working with you. So thanks for everything you do.
Well, it makes appreciate a difference you. In our district, and especially on the campuses with the partnership, so thank you.
Awesome. All right. Yeah, you can clap for that. So the reason we show you that is just because we want you to know, first of all, that it is making a difference, and secondly, we want you to be involved in that and continue to support it and continue to know that what you're doing, what you're providing, is making a difference. It's making a difference beyond these walls. And, you know, of course, Kent ISD is the largest employer in this community, and every kid in this community who's within these city limits, most of those kids go through, of course, Kent ISD. And so it makes sense for us as a church, if we want to be effective, to go to places like that and to be salt and light, to be a light in our community that desperately needs us. So when we ask you for things like, hey, we're going to go fill up the break room at Navarro Elementary School, you know, those things are important. And delivering on those things is important, because the worst thing that could possibly happen is we say, hey, we're in a partnership, but we don't do anything, right? We don't show up for that partnership. We don't bring the things that we say we're going to bring. So when you hear those things, when those messages go out, I realize that you've got your busy lives and you've got all kinds of things going on, but this is an opportunity. And it's an opportunity for us to go far beyond the walls of this church and reach far more people than we might otherwise reach. And so I want to encourage you, when you get a call from us, when you receive an email from us, when you hear an announcement in here about participating in that, do it. It's making a difference, okay? It's making a difference. I also want to let you know, we have a little interactive wall just on the other side of that wall right there. There is kind of a magnetic board. It's like a little art piece, but it's interactive. And on that wall, we have each of our campuses that we partner with. And then we have places for you to write prayers or encouragements. There's also a section for needs. If you're a teacher here or an administrator and you have some needs, go out there and write your need, and we'll take care of that need. We want to be available for you in any way that we can. But I want to encourage y'all, go out there and write your encouragements for a teacher. Can you imagine being a teacher in this day and age? It'd be tough. My wife is now a teacher at Corsicana High School. Did y'all know that? She's teaching health science this year. So they need encouragement. Trust me, she is so nervous and worried about it, but they need encouragement. They need prayers. They need to know that we're with them. They need to know that we're willing to help. And they need to know, most of all, that God loves them, right? And let me tell you, ultimately, sorry, I'm preaching now, okay, on this. I wasn't planning on this, but let me tell you ultimately what happens. For some reason, the church has taken a posture where we're angry with the schools all the time. And what we've decided to do is take a posture where we want to serve the schools. And we want to bring the love of God to the schools. And let me tell you why that's important. Because if we ever do get angry at the schools, we have a relationship where we can talk about it. Yep. And we can go in there and be heard instead of just being noise. Right? Yep. So this is an important thing. And we want to make sure that we build a relationship with an institution around here that serves the majority of the next generation in this community. So support it if you can. All right. Here we go. We're going into our last message on Jonah. Have you enjoyed the Jonah series so far? Good. You're not going to enjoy it today. Today is going to be my opportunity to verbally abuse you through this passage, because, I mean, look, God is rough in this one. This is a rough passage, all right? So buckle up, put your seatbelts on. As always, let me give you this disclaimer. It is never my intention to be harsh with you, okay? I love you. I am so thankful that you're here. I know you got a lot of other places you could be on a Sunday morning, not the least of which is bed, right? And you are here, and so I'm so thankful that you're here and that you make this a priority in your life. But sometimes we run up against a passage in Scripture that is tough, where God is communicating a message to us that is not easy to hear and that steps on our toes. And so that's what the passage is giving us today. And I'm just going to further that. I'm going to take that where it goes, and we'll see how it goes. And I'm not going to give you a whole bunch of introduction. You know the introduction already. You know what happened to Jonah, right? God told Jonah to go to Nineveh to preach against the Ninevites. Jonah said, no, I'm going the exact opposite direction. And he took a boat in the complete opposite direction to Tarshish. And while he's on that boat going the opposite direction, he falls asleep in the lower deck. And God sends a storm upon Jonah's boat. And the storm is just raging. And all the sailors on the boat say, oh my gosh, what did we do wrong? This has to be some sort of judgment from God. And they begin to investigate, and they finally realize that God is angry with Jonah, and he's trying to get Jonah's attention. And so these guys wake Jonah up, and they say, you got to pray to your God so that this storm will stop. So Jonah wakes up. Finally, they realize, hey, nothing's going to work unless we just throw you overboard. And God actually tells them, hey, throw him overboard. So they throw him overboard, and God sends a great fish, a big fish, right to where Jonah is thrown overboard. The fish swallows Jonah. He lives for 3 days and three nights in the belly of a great fish. And 3 days and three nights later, he is vomited up right by Nineveh, right? And he goes into Nineveh, he walks through the city for a day, and he preaches to them. He preaches eight words to them. I don't remember exactly what they are, but it's something like this. You better quit doing what you're doing or you're going to be destroyed, right? That's it. Nineveh, in 8 days, Nineveh is going to be destroyed. Well, that causes a revival. The proclamation that God has given Jonah is accompanied by God's power, and that causes a revival. And the Ninevites, all of them, the Ninevites turn from their sin and they turn toward God. And God rescues these people by bringing Jonah to them. Well, in chapter 4, we get to see what finally happens with Jonah. And what we find out is that his heart does not align with God's heart. And let me tell you, when you're in trouble as a believer, you're in trouble as a believer when your heart does not align with God's heart. And so I want to show you from this passage, from chapter 4, how you know that your heart is not aligned with God's heart. That's why this is a hard chapter. And the number one sign of rebellion from God, of resisting God, of a heart that is not aligned with God's heart, the number one sign of that, we're going to find very early on. Let's read the passage together, and then we'll talk about what it says to us today. It says this, "But Jonah was greatly displeased and became angry." He was greatly displeased and became angry. He prayed to the Lord, "Oh Lord, is this not what I said when I was still at home? That is why I was so quick to flee to Tarshish. I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, oh Lord, take away my life, for it is better for me to die than to live." But the Lord replied, "Is it right for you to be angry? Is it right for you to be angry?" Jonah had gone out and sat down at a place east of the city. There he made himself a shelter, sat in its shade, and waited to see what would happen to the city. Then the Lord provided a leafy plant and made it grow up over Jonah to give shade for his head to ease his discomfort. And Jonah was very happy about the plant. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm, which chewed the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God provided a scorching east wind, and the sun blazed on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. We wouldn't know anything about that, would we? He wanted to die and said, "It would be better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" "It is," he said, and I'm so angry, I wish I were dead. And the very last part of this passage, but the Lord said, you have been concerned about this plant, though you did not tend it or make it grow. It sprang up overnight and died overnight. And should I not have concern for the great city of Nineveh, in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, and also many animals? It's a real interesting passage, right? I mean, that's it. That's the way this book ends. Let's make some sense of this. I think the number one sign that we know that our heart is not aligned with God's heart is when you are displeased by the grace of God. When you are displeased by the grace of God, that's how you know that your heart is not aligned with God's heart. What are some examples of that? Well, look at Jonah. Jonah was greatly displeased and became angry. That greatly displeased, that literally means that he viewed God's grace as a great evil. That's the way it's translated in Hebrew. Jonah saw a great evil, and he became angry. So the grace of God toward Nineveh, God spared these wicked, evil people. God sent Jonah to preach to them. They had a revival. What Jonah should have been doing is saying, oh my gosh, I can't believe God did this incredible work and saved all these people. God rescued them. How gracious is God? How amazing is his grace? That's what he should have said. But instead, he was displeased by the grace of God. He saw God's goodness as a great evil. And don't forget, this is God's man. This is a guy who believes in God. This is a guy who, every time they ask him who he is, he says, I'm a Hebrew and I worship the living God who created all things and who sustains all things. He knows who God is. He believes in God. And he's mad when God rescues sinners. And man, y'all, I just have to tell you that this reminds me a lot of the church. Sometimes we're mad when God gives his grace to people who we think don't deserve it. Sometimes we're mad at that. Sometimes we're mad when people do gracious acts for others and we think they don't deserve it. Oh, you shouldn't have given that guy something to eat. He's just going to be back here out on the street again tomorrow. He doesn't deserve it. You should have given that to me instead. I'd have made good use of that money. You know? Why God rescue you? You mean to tell me God's going to rescue somebody and bring somebody to salvation who's done evil in their life? Why do they deserve God's forgiveness? We get mad because we think we know what fairness is better than God does. And we get irritated when God shows mercy and kindness to people who we think don't deserve it. And when you do that, you are not aligned with the heart of God. Here's the irony of this story. Jonah was fine with God's grace when he was receiving it. Remember chapter 2? The fish comes up, swallows Jonah. And we talked about this. They didn't have rescue rafts at the time. They didn't have the little, you know, donut life preserver that they could throw out there and say, hey, grab on, we'll pull you to safety. So God did a brilliant thing. He sent a great fish, and that fish swallowed Jonah, and that was his life raft. That's what kept him alive. He either survived in the belly of the fish, or he died. And he knew it. He prayed all of chapter 2. He prays, thank you, God, for rescuing me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you. While the seaweed was choking me and I was falling down into the depths of the sea, sure to die, you rescued me. Thank you for doing that, God. He was fine with God's grace then, wasn't he? But all of a sudden, God gives his grace to these other people, to those people. And all of a sudden, he's mad. And we got to examine ourselves in light of this. When God shows grace to sinners, does it make you rejoice? Or does it make you disgusted? Do you get excited when God saves a wicked person? Or do you get irritated that God didn't punish that person for the bad things they did? Do you love it when God helps someone by giving them rent money? Or do you think that money would have been better spent on someone good like you? Do you have God's heart for grace, or does grace bother you? I heard this quote this week. I want you to listen to it. I don't have it on the screen, but listen to it. You can tell you have made God in your image when it turns out he hates all the same people you do. You can tell you made God in your image when it turns out he hates all the same people you do. So are you making God in your image? Because, boy, he hates all those people, you know. God hates those people who have a different political opinion than you. God hates all those people who have a different opinion on gender than you do. God hates all those people who have different opinions on all sorts of varying issues. God hates them just like you do. And that's the way a lot of people live their lives. But guess what? What if God doesn't hate them? What if God wants to rescue them? What if God wants to love them just like he loved you? What if God wants to exercise the same amazing grace that saved you on them? Do you think it's any more of a miracle that God saved you than that he would save somebody you hate? Because there's probably somebody out there who doesn't like you and doesn't want you to receive God's grace. Thank God he didn't listen to them. And thank God he doesn't listen to you. So here's what happens from here. You know, when you are displeased by the grace of God, you're in rebellion. You're resisting God, and your heart's not aligned with him. But here's what happens with Jonah. He leaves the city. He goes east of the city. He's still probably hoping that God will take it all back and destroy that city, and then he'll have a front row seat to it. That's probably what he's hoping for. And he goes and he sits down, and three things happen. God provides a vine in verse 6, God provides a worm in verse 7, and God provides a scorching east wind in verse 8. And what we learn from that is this. Our heart is not aligned with God when we're only happy when God does the things that make us happy. If you're only happy when God does the things that make you happy, your heart is not aligned with God. Let me explain why we see that here. See, the vine was a good thing because it gave Jonah shade. This vine grows up and it gives Jonah shade. It was hot there. I've been over there before. It's hot. It's like a desert. Incredibly hot. And this vine grows up and Jonah's sitting under there and he's pouting, but the vine is giving him some shade and it's giving him some relief from the heat. It's like a beach umbrella, right? So he's sitting there and he's getting relief from the shade, but then God sends a worm to eat the vine. And then God sends a scorching east wind, And so now Jonah, he went from being comfortable under the shade of the vine to the worm eating the vine to a wind blowing, which is just what you want on a warm day, right? You want wind blowing on a hot day, but you don't want hot wind blowing. We know all about this right now, don't we? And the other day I was outside, it was 107, and I was like, man, I wish I could just get a breeze. And I got one, like a 5 to 10 mile an hour breeze blew up. And it was like I was in a sauna and somebody turned on a space heater. That's what the breeze felt like, you know? It was a hot breeze. It was terrible. And so here's the thing you got to realize about this. God sent all of these things, right? God sent the vine, God sent the worm, and God sent the scorching breeze. God sent all of these things. But Jonah was only happy when the vine was there. He liked it when God did something that made him feel good. He didn't like it when God did something that didn't make him feel good. That makes sense, right? The real question boils down to this. Will Jonah be happy with God only when God makes him happy, or will he be happy even when God doesn't live up to his expectations? And that's the question you got to ask yourself too. Are you only happy with God when good things are going on with you? When good things are happening to you? When your circumstances are good? Is that the only time that you're happy with God? Is that the only time you feel blessed by God? I think one of the biggest dangers to Christianity today and one of the biggest dangers to the church today is that we think God exists to make us happy. We think God exists to make us happy. And we have developed a whole belief system around that. And I don't think it's true. What do we do when God doesn't live up to our expectations? What happens when we don't experience healing from disease? What happens when our relationship doesn't work out? What happens when our family member dies? What happens when our child doesn't respond to our parenting? What happens when we want to get married and things fall apart and we have to stay single? When life doesn't make us happy, do we blame God and treat him like he got our order wrong at McDonald's? I want to talk to the manager. He messed up. This is not what I ordered. And it took way too long to get it. God is not our vending machine. Now look, God's not up there saying, let me make Steve miserable. But I want you to understand, God is not up there going, I know Steve needs this. I know he needs to develop the things that are going to come through this difficult situation. I'm going to allow this to happen. Never mind. I take that back. Steve's not going to be happy if this happens. So I'm not going to let it happen now. I want to make him happy. So I'm going to make everything swell and good with him. How arrogant of us to think that. You know, I think a lot of times we are spoiled brats. You ever had one of those days when you woke up early? You had an incredibly busy day. You were running like crazy every different direction. Came home as quickly as you could, but you were late. Cooked a meal, threw something together as quick as you could, and you were like, hey, this is actually going to be good. And then you sit down with the family to dinner, and one of your kids says, this is what we're eating? I'm not eating that. I'll just have some cereal. You know how you feel in that moment? I think that must have been kind of the way God felt with Jonah. We're like, God, I know you hold everything together and you do all things for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purposes. And I know you have been working nonstop to not only provide a hope and a future for me, but you made a way to save us from death and hell. But I don't really like this meal you cooked for me today. It doesn't make me happy. Couldn't you have done something else that would have made me happy? And look, I don't think I'm going to do this. I think I'll do my own thing instead. Because you're not providing for my happiness enough. And I know if I do what I want, I'll be happy. What a bunch of spoiled brats we can be sometimes. The Ninevites came to know God. And Jonah wasn't happy about it. So God does something pretty cool here. I think this is kind of awesome. God says, you're not happy? Oh, let me show you not happy. I'll give you something to not be happy about, right? Here's a vine. You like that? Feeling good under the vine? Nice and cool under there, isn't it, Jonah? Here's a worm. That worm's going to eat your vine. And just to top it off, here's a scorching hot breeze. Enjoy your day. Hope you're happy. It's pretty awesome what God does here. Listen, if you are displeased by the grace of God, and if you're only going to be happy when God does things that make you happy, then your heart doesn't align with God's heart. Now, the final thing we see here is that our hearts don't align with God's heart when we are outwardly obedient and inwardly rotten. When we're outwardly obedient but inwardly rotten, we are out of alignment with God's heart. And this little drama with Jonah, it raises a pretty interesting question. And the question is, did Jonah ever really repent? Did Jonah ever really repent? Well, you could read chapter 1, where it says, go to Nineveh and preach against the Ninevites, and Jonah goes the other direction. You could say, no, he didn't really repent. Then you could read chapter 2, where he prays the whole time and thanks God for saving him, and chapter 3, where he does go to Nineveh, and he does preach to them, and you could say, yeah, he repented. But then when you get to chapter 4, you read about his terrible attitude and how he's just such a spoiled brat. And his heart doesn't align with God. You could say, I don't know. I don't know if he repented or not. Maybe yes, maybe no. But one thing it does show us is that you can believe in God and you can trust in God, and you can have a terrible attitude. You can be obedient to God for all the wrong reasons. You can do things in the church, and you can almost like undo all the help that you are with a terrible attitude, right? And the whole time I was reading this, I was reminded that sometimes God's greatest problem is the sinner out there, But sometimes the bigger problem is the saint in here. Sometimes the problem is the sinner out there, but a lot of times the bigger problem is the saint right in here. And it reminded me of Psalm 51. I thought of this all week where it says, you do not desire a sacrifice or I would offer one. You do not want a burnt offering. The sacrifice you desire is a broken spirit. You will not reject a broken and repentant heart, O God. He's talking to the Hebrews and he's saying, like, you think what I really want from you is a sacrifice. You think what I really want from you is all this stuff. You think what I really want from you are all these behaviors that look good on the outside, but what I really want from you is a broken heart, a repentant heart, a heart that connects with me. Anybody can do behaviors, but are you doing them with the right heart? Jesus said something like this. He says, you know, you act like you love me, but your hearts are far from me. That was Jonah's problem. He was outwardly obedient, but he was inwardly rotten. So what do we do with this? What do we do with this? Well, what we do is we examine ourselves and go, you know what? I'm out of alignment. I've got to align with God. I've got to love the grace of God, the radical grace of God. I've got to look at everybody around me and see that maybe they're from Nineveh, that maybe God's heart is for them. We can't afford as God's people to walk around and be disgusted all the time. For some of you, that's going to be your temptation. You're going to get roped into the political discourse of this kingdom, this world, and you're going to want to be angry with the world all the time.
Oh, this world's just going to hell in a handbasket. Ugh, it's crazy. Boy, God, the heart of God is so broken by these horrible people running our country into the ground. And that's going to be your narrative, and it's going to be over and over and over again, and you're going to get discipled by the news channels instead of by God's word. And you're going to walk around angry all the time, thinking that God doesn't have a heart for the people around you. And you are not going to be aligned with the heart of God that is gracious and wants to avoid the chaos and calamity. So here's the deal. The world is full of Ninevehs today. And God is still looking for someone to go there. And we ask the question, did Jonah repent? Well, who do you think wrote the book? The worm? Or the plant? Jonah wrote the book. And that gives me hope that Jonah saw need for us to read the book and see ourselves in it. And to turn from our ways and to turn from our hatred of everything and instead develop the heart of God. I think Jonah wrote this book and it's very self-deprecating. And I think he wants us to look at it and say, I'm not going to be that way. When God calls me to deliver his message to Nineveh, I'm going to go. And I'm going to love the grace of God. And I'm going to deliver that message with love and compassion and a heart for people who need God. See, Nineveh here is a literal city, but it also represents all the great cities of the world. And even more than that, it stands for the people that only you can reach.
for the place that only you can go, for the opportunity that only you can fill. So where do you need to go? Who do you need to talk to? And what's the opportunity that only you can fill? You've got a Nineveh in your life right now. You've got an opportunity to express alignment with the heart of God around you right now. It might be a friend where you work. It might be that group you hang around with after work. It might be your neighbors down the street. It might be the women at the PTA or the guys in the bowling league. I hope some of y'all are in a bowling league. That'd be really cool. Who knows? Your Nineveh might be your husband or your wife or your grown-up kids. Your Nineveh might be someone you love whose behavior has provoked you to the point of anger or bitterness. Your Nineveh might be a new job in a new city or a home on a new street. Your Nineveh ultimately stands for any part of the will of God that you are afraid to face. That's Nineveh. You're afraid to go, but God wants you there. You're afraid to speak up, but there are people who need to hear what you have to say. You're afraid to make a move, but God says, trust me. I love this person. I want to exercise my grace toward this person. Trust me. Nineveh is calling you today. What are you going to do about it? You going to continue living with a heart that's out of alignment with God? Or are you going to surrender to the Lord and allow Him to lead you to your Nineveh? And maybe, just like He did with Jonah, maybe He'll bring revival. Really, the only question is, are you gonna be part of that revival out of alignment with God or in alignment with God? Because really what He wants from you is not a sacrifice or a burnt offering. He wants a broken and contrite heart. He wants you aligned with Him. Y'all bow your heads, close your eyes, and consider these things. Where's your Nineveh today? Who's a person around you who needs Jesus? You don't want to talk to them. You don't want to be there with them. You'd much rather judge them or divert your attention away from them or act like they don't exist, but they do exist. And maybe God wants you to go to them. Picture their face. Whisper their name. And ask God to move your will to where you are in alignment with Him and you're ready to be who He's called you to be, with who He's called you to be with. Father, we come to You right now thankful for our time in the book of Jonah. We've always read this book and thought of it almost like some sort of children's story. We remember the big fish and all that stuff, but really You've shown us that it's far more than that. It's really a story about whether or not we're going to obey You with a heart that's for You or whether we're going to resist You. And none of us get to resist You and enjoy You. So I pray, Lord, that would no longer resist you, that we would surrender to you, that we would obey you, and that our hearts would align with your heart. Thank you for the amazing grace that you've given to us, Lord, and may we be the kind of people who distribute that grace freely, gladly, joyfully. Not people who are stingy with it. And we pray all of it in Jesus' name. Amen. Y'all stand with me this morning. We're going to worship together. I want to encourage you, if you need to come and talk to one of us, Natalie's here and Jess is here and I'm here, feel free to come. We'll be happy to pray with you. But what I really like for you to do is kind of in a somber way reflect on everything that we talked about today. Like reflect on whether or not you are in alignment with the Lord. And if you're not, ask him to align you. Let's worship together.
Through it all, through it all.
you, Lord, for loving us and being so good to us, in spite of the fact that even sometimes after we know you, we can get it so wrong about who you are and what your heart is for us to do. And so, Lord, bend us to your will. Align us with your heart. May we start to look at the world in the way that the book of Jonah teaches us to look at the world, not with anger or resentment or lack of grace, but instead with a heart that is like the heart of God. May we be able to say that we align with what Jonah said about you, that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. May we be the messengers of that to the world around us, because our heart is aligned with your grace. Thank you for your grace, God. Pray all of it in Jesus' name. Amen. I thank y'all for coming today. Love you. We'll see you next week. We're starting a new series called I'm Glad You Asked. Next week we'll talk about, does prayer really matter? We'll see you next week.